Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Radical Sacrifice by Terry Eagleton. Narrated by Roger Clark. When someone freely embraces the symbols of death or death itself, a great release of power for good can be expected to follow. Mary Douglas, Purity and Danger, 1966. Preface. The chapters of this book are part of a broader project, one that turns on a set of ideas which seem to have become central to my later work: death, tragedy, sacrifice, dispossession, and the like. For those who might find these conceptions rather too gloomy, I should add that there is also a good deal in the study about renewal, transformation, and revolution, which I see as the other face of the darker notions I've just listed. Like some other of my recent works, then, this one broods upon questions not commonly investigated by the political left, and certainly not by its postmodern wing. Love, death, suffering, sacrifice, evil, martyrdom, forgiveness, and so on are not exactly modish preoccupations among cultural or political theorists today. They are more usually the concern of theologians. And if I myself do not take the dismissive attitude to theology generally to be found among left-wingers, this is because, through a quirk of upbringing, I happen to know a little about it. I know enough, anyway, to be convinced that a great many secular views of the Judaic and Christian lineages are as grossly prejudiced and abysmally ill-informed as those, say, for whom socialism is simply a matter of the gulag, or feminism, the calamitous consequence of women throwing their natural modesty and decorum to the winds. One of the more polemical aims of this book, then, though one that remains largely implicit, is to show up some of these attitudes for the lamentable travesties they are. When it comes to theology, even the most subtle of secular thinkers are at risk of stumbling into a mire of dreary clichés and risible misconceptions. It is, in fact, no more strange that one like myself, indebted to the Marxist legacy, should take an interest in theology than that a liberal or social democrat should take an interest in Stendhal or Flaubert. For Marxism is a theory and practice of historical change, not a vision of human existence, and as such is not intended to have anything particularly arresting to say about evil or mortality, suffering or forgiveness, tragic breakdown, or the nature of nihilism. For such questions, one tends rather to have recourse to Dostoevsky or St. Paul, Shakespeare or Sebald. Chapter 1. Radical Sacrifice. Sacrifice has not proved the most glamorous of notions in the modern age. It smacks of self-abasement and punitive self-denial. It is what long-suffering wives do for their imperious husbands, maidservants for their pampered mistresses, nurses and steelworkers for the good of the economy, and stormtroopers for the fatherland. An exhausted mother in Edward St. Aubyn's novel Mother's Milk, her life in pieces and her desires unfulfilled, speaks of the tyranny of self-sacrifice. The notion is redolent of masochism, self-loathing and a morbid antipathy to what makes for life. It begins as an attempt to placate a savage god, and culminates in the clarion call of the fascist fatherland, with its necrophiliac rites and ceremonies of self-oblation. J.M. Coetzee writes in Life and Times of Michael Kay of how someone may be simply another brick in the pyramid of sacrifice that someone would eventually climb and stand straddle-legged on top of, roaring and beating his chest and announcing himself emperor of all he surveyed. G.W.F. Hegel, a thinker sometimes mistakenly thought to take a sanguine view of the human condition, writes, "Even as we look at history as the slaughter bench on which the happiness of nations, the wisdom of states, and the virtue of individuals have been sacrificed, a question also necessarily arises in our thoughts. To what final end have these monstrous sacrifices been made?" For conventional liberal wisdom, self-fulfillment and self-dispossession are essentially at odds. This is not the case for a more radical outlook. One must take a remarkably indulgent view of humankind, as many a liberal does, to assume that the self can come into its own without that fundamental breaking and refashioning of which sacrifice has been one traditional sign. It would be the equivalent of claiming that the forms of political life we see around us could evolve into a state of justice without any notable degree of turbulence. Those who oppose sacrifice to the mutuality of love forget that any durable version of the latter involves the self-giving typical of the former. There is indeed a species of sacrificial love that involves wreaking violence upon the self. The problem is to refuse this death-dealing ideology while recognizing with Hegel that in a more fruitful sense of the term, the inner structure of love is sacrificial in any case, though we are speaking once again of reciprocal self-giving, not of the abject capitulation of one partner to the dominion of the other. As one commentary puts it, sacrifice and self-denial are not a goal in themselves, but the substance of forgetting one's own self in loving the other. Forgetting is a questionable claim, given that love enhances the self in the very act of decentering it. Even so, it provides a useful corrective to the fashionable view that sacrifice is necessarily a form of self-mutilation. That orthodoxy has been well nigh unanimous in repudiating the concept of sacrifice as barbarous and benighted. In the wake of Thomas Hobbes, for whom the highest moral duty is self-preservation, Ronald Dworkin claims that one's responsibility for others cannot extend to excessive self-sacrifice, given that one's primary obligation is to one's own life. It is a brand of ethics well suited to middle-class suburbia. There is indeed, in Dworkin's view, a moral duty to come to the aid of others, but only if the difficulties they face are severe, the cost of the assistance is tolerable, and those who require such help depend on you in particular to provide it. In similar spirit, John Rawls opposes the idea of sacrifice for the greater good, denying that a loss of freedom for the few can be justified by the welfare of the many. Jürgen Habermas claims that rational morality puts its seal on the abolition of sacrifice, no doubt with slain goats rather than the dead of the French Resistance in mind. It is remarkable that when the term sacrifice enters the discussion, the modern liberal mind turns spontaneously to such issues as domestic servitude and death in the cause of military glory, rather than to the career of Konstantin Markievicz or the death of Malcolm X. The modern era's skepticism of sacrifice is nowhere more evident than in its uncertain grasp of the notion. By and large, it has come to mean the voluntary relinquishing of what one finds valuable. But renunciation is only one feature of sacrifice, and not always the most prominent. It is true that it can play a major role in the practice. In his classic study, Primitive Culture, the Victorian anthropologist Edward Burnett Tylor argues that the sacrificial gift is prized by the gods not for itself, but as a token of the worshippers yielding up of something precious. The gift must be part of one's own substance, so that to surrender it exacts a certain cost. Yet it is not obvious that ritual sacrifice is primarily about self-deprivation. You may sacrificially kill a fatted calf not to rob yourself of your prized beast, but to pay the gods the most sumptuous tribute you can muster. Sacrifice cannot be reduced to self-denial. The term is a richly layered one. So much so, in fact, that one eminent French scholar has cast doubt on whether the term has much meaning at all. David Janssen is another to question the possibility of a general theory of sacrifice, insisting on how the meaning of the institution shifts from one cultural context to another, indeed from one book of the Hebrew Bible to another, and issuing a rebuke to René Girard, doyen of sacrificial theory, for passing over this vital point. Ancient Israel had names for different forms of sacrifice, but no name for the institution as such. There is no discernible essence to the custom, which, since the dawn of time, has fulfilled a striking diversity of functions. It can be anything from a form of celestial bribery, I'll give you this if you'll give me that, to the act of martyrdom, in which one makes a gift of one's death to others. Sacrifice is a polythetic term, encompassing a range of activities that need have no single feature in common. It has been understood at various times as gift, tribute, covenant, prayer, bargain, gratitude, atonement, adoration, cajolement, celebration, restitution, expiation, sanctification, propitiation, communion, fellowship, purification, and discharge of debt. It can involve a redemptive death, a purging of evil, a refusal of death, a dialogue with divinity, a restoration of cosmic order, or a prudent investment in order to secure a profitable return. There are those who have regarded it as a rite of passage, or reinforcement of patriarchal power, whereas others have found in it a source of social cohesion, a liberation of vital energies, a ritual working through of guilt or trauma, or a species of mourning. Giorgio Agamben sees it as a way of providing an ungrounded social existence with an origin and foundation. Walter Burkert's Homo Nicans treats it, among other things, as a form of ritual atonement for the slaying of animals. The practice has also been understood as an attempt to win the attention of the gods, a gesture of obedience to the moral law or social code, or a token of one's membership of the nation. If some thinkers discern in such rites an attempt to draw the gods nearer, others find in them an effort to fend them off. For psychoanalytic thought, it is by sacrificial self-repression that the subject first emerges into being, trading its jouissance for a certain fragile autonomy. But sacrifice can also be understood as a devious way of buttressing the self by diminishing it, as Max Horkheimer and Theodor Adorno argue in Dialectic of Enlightenment. Humanity, they argue, can exercise dominion over the world all the more effectively by violently laying waste to its own inner nature. Horkheimer and Adorno view ritual sacrifice as, among other things, a duplicitous ploy to wheedle and hoodwink the Olympians. It may also serve as a way of propitiating nature for that treasonable abandonment of it, which is the precondition of human subjectivity. In his Lectures on Hegel, Alexander Koyeve understands the philosopher is arguing that the human subject will sacrifice all, risk everything, stake its very life for the summum bonum of recognition. Indeed, for Hegel, subjectivity is itself a form of sacrifice, since to accede to meaning is to abandon being, or as Jacques Lacan puts it, the symbol is the death of the thing. Once reality is articulated, carved up into a play of difference, we shall never recapture that sensuous repleteness we enjoyed before the birth of the signifier, or at least fantasized that we did. At the same time, Hegel refuses throughout his work to regard sacrifice in terms of expiation, seeing it instead as an act of love and gratitude. In his Neue Religion, E.E. Evans Pritchard speaks of sacrifice in terms of purchase, indemnification, homage, gift, abnegation, expulsion, ransom, elimination, bargain, exchange, communion, absolution, and rebirth. It seems improbable that these wildly diverse functions can be gathered into a single theory. Catherine McClymond reminds us that death is by no means indispensable to the ceremony. Sacrificial tributes can be liquid and vegetal as well as animal. In the book of Genesis, Cain plumps for the former while Abel opts for the latter. Roger Beckwith points out that the idea of sacrifice in the Christian gospel spans a number of activities: praise, thanksgiving, prayer, witness, peacemaking, dedication to God, and the like, that we ourselves would not customarily include under that heading. For the Hebrew scriptures, even reading the Torah can be a sacrificial act. Tyler is convinced that sacrifice is above all a question of offering gifts to celestial beings. To begin with, he maintains, the gods are thought to appreciate these offerings for what they are in themselves. Then they come to be grasped in symbolic terms, as acts of homage and piety. And finally, their value is seen to lie in the donor's self-denial. The focus thus shifts from gifts to givers, from gratifying the gods to the spiritual state of those engaged in doing so. William Robertson Smith, by contrast, regards sacrifice as a form of communal feasting, one which powerfully cements social bonds. Marcel Detien and Jean-Pierre Vernon argue a similar case in The Cuisine of Sacrifice Among the Greeks. In The Golden Bough, James George Frazer prefers to highlight the death of the priest or king. In their classic work, Sacrifice, Its Nature and Functions, Henri Hubert and Marcel Mauss regard sacrifice primarily as a mediation between sacred and profane domains. Sacrificial tributes are as diverse as the institution itself. Like the Freudian drive, the impulse to sacrifice would seem, in the phenomenological sense of the term, non-intentional, indifferent to the nature of its object. Edmund Leach points out that for sacrificial purposes, the Noia sometimes replace oxen with wild cucumber. A sheep may be as good as a man for winning divine favor. To speak of such metaphorical substitution is to remind ourselves that there is a semiotics of sacrifice, in which the gift as communicative sign may be purely arbitrary or unmotivated, or where the relation between signifier and signified, donor and offering is iconic, as when the spotlessness of the gift is taken to signify the blamelessness of the giver. There are also tributes which, like the poetic sign, may be especially communicative precisely because they are rich in inherent value. A donation may be metonymic, in the sense of standing in for the rest of one's material resources, or metaphorical, as with the substitution of beasts for humans. There is a view that a conflict over the semiotics of sacrifice lay behind the fracas unleashed by Jesus over the money changers in the temple, a brawl that may well have led directly to his execution. The most compelling version of sacrifice concerns the flourishing of the self, not its extinction. It involves a formidable release of energy, a transformation of the human subject, and a turbulent transitus from death to new life. If sacrifice is a political act, it is not least because it concerns an accession to power. As one commentator remarks, almost all sacrifice is about power or powers. The ritual is indeed about loss and waste, but in the name of a more fruitful form of life. Julian of Norwich sees it in terms of childbirth, where pain is a prelude to joy. If sacrifice involves yielding something up, it is in order to possess it more deeply. As Hubert and Mauss observe, there is no sacrifice into which some idea of redemption does not enter. It is true that the institution has a number of retrograde features, as its critics have been at pains to point out. It has been, for the most part, a profoundly conservative practice. Yet there is a radical kernel to be extracted from its mystical shell. Sacrifice concerns the passage of the lowly, unremarkable thing from weakness to power. It marks a movement from victimhood to full humanity, destitution to riches, the world as we know it to some transfigured domain. It is this disruptive rite of passage that is known, among other things, as consecration. To make an object sacred is to mark it out by investing it with a sublimely dangerous power. If sacrifice is often violent, it is because the depth of the change it promises cannot be a matter of smooth evolution or simple continuity. In this sense, the practice of ritual sacrifice nurtures a wisdom beyond the rationality of the modern, at least at its most callow. It sets its face against the consoling illusion that fulfillment can be achieved without a fundamental rupture and rebirth. The consecration of the sacrificial victim is a matter of wholesale transformation, not some piecemeal evolution. One cannot pass from time to eternity while remaining intact. Since the gods are totally other to humanity, any contact with them involves a metamorphosis as fundamental as the passage from living to dying. The idea of sacrifice broods, among other things, on the mystery by which life springs from death, seeking a passage through loss and devastation in order to thrive. Dennis J. Schmidt writes of how, for Hegel, conflict, contradiction, negation, sacrifice, and death saturate the life of the spirit so thoroughly that they define the very truth of the spirit. In a similar vein, Miguel de Bestgy observes that one should recognize that for Hegel, the greatness of spirit in history or of man in his action reveals itself primarily in sundering and in death, in sacrifice and in struggle, and that thought itself derives its depth only from taking the full measure of this tragic grandeur. Pre-modern societies are conscious in a similar way of a secret complicity between living and dying. If the fumes of burnt offerings no longer waft to the nostrils of petulant deities in our own time, it is partly because modernity enforces a rigorous distinction between the two states. In one ancient view, social existence itself can be sustained only by a power that has passed through death and self-dispossession, through the madness and delirium that Hegel calls the night of the world. Bridges stay up, and crops are persuaded to grow only on account of the consecrated carcasses buried beneath them. Without a cement of innocent blood, writes W. H. Auden in Horae Canonicae, no secular wall will ever safely stand. The power of death is pressed into the service of the living. As Thanatos for Freud conspires with Eros to pluck a civilization from the mire. In this sense, it is death that brings the value of life into focus. In the experience of killing, writes Walter Burkert in a comment on sacrifice, one perceives the sacredness of life. It is nourished and perpetuated by death. In tribal societies, he adds, the power to kill and a respect for life are mutually illuminating. The modern practice of suicide is a monstrous perversion of the belief that life springs from self-dispossession. In its most extreme form, comments George Heyman, the act of sacrificial killing affirms and enhances life itself. Ritual sacrifice is affirmative in a number of ways, because the slaughtered victim enters by its death upon eternal life, becoming all-powerful and invulnerable in the process. Because its loss makes us freshly conscious of the fragility of life, which in turn enriches our sense of its preciousness, and because to destroy the offering serves by contrast to highlight the boundless reserves of natural and human existence, which can easily survive such a privation. The slaying of the sacrificial tribute signifies a radical self-dispossession on the part of the donor, which is in turn made possible by an exuberant excess of life. Only one furnished with such prodigious riches, such as Friedrich Nietzsche's Übermensch, would feel self-assured enough to yield up a portion of them. The Übermensch sacrifices others for the greater good of the species, but he also makes sacrifices himself, bestowing his largesse upon those around him. It is richness in personality Abundance in oneself, Nietzsche writes, in The Will to Power, overflowing and bestowing, instinctive good health and affirmation of oneself that produce great sacrifice and great love. Yet if giving is as easy as this, a spontaneous overflow from one's ceaselessly replenished depths, it is hard to see how one can speak of it as sacrifice at all, any more than one can speak of Timon's reckless self-squandering in Shakespeare's Timon of Athens as a form of self-abandonment. If the self's powers are fathomless, there can be no question of dispossession. Whatever is to endure and be effective, writes Burkert, must pass through a sacrifice which opens the abyss of annihilation. The life of the spirit, Hegel writes in a legendary sentence in Phenomenology of Spirit, is not the life that shrinks from death and keeps itself untouched by devastation, but rather the life that endures it and maintains itself within it. He speaks of the tragedy which the absolute eternally enacts with itself, by eternally giving birth to itself into objectivity, submitting in this objective form to passion and death, and rising from its ashes in glory. The Hegelian absolute is thus sacrificial in its inmost structure, losing itself in otherness and negativity as a prelude to reuniting with itself, descending into hell in order to be reborn as affirmative spirit. Finitude must negate itself in order to come into its own. The absolute must renounce itself in entering upon material existence, rather as Christ represents the Father's kenotic self-abandonment. In the act of sacrifice, the absolute nature of death invests those mortal things that can expose themselves to its terror with an imperishable form of life. For Christian faith, only an existence tempered and refined by death, having passed through the symbolic drowning of baptism and fed in sign on the flesh of a martyr, is resilient enough to overcome sin, rape, genocide, slavery, exploitation, and the like. If some cultures know this transitus as sacrifice, others give it the name of tragedy. There are also places, ancient Greece for example, where this obscure affinity between living and dying goes under both titles. In modernity, writes Giorgio Agamben, the principle of the sacredness of life is completely emancipated from sacrificial ideology. For this ideology, there is an obscene underside to everyday existence, a telltale bloodstain imprinted on its fabric, with which its ceremonial rites seek to come to terms. Nietzsche saw sacrifice in the sense of an inescapable cruelty and exploitation lying at the foundation of human culture, and so as a phenomenon to be celebrated. In the words of one commentator, sacrifice is aware of a brokenness at the basis and origin of life. It can signify return to the origins of the tribe or nation, and as such involves a meditation on the violence of that inaugural moment, one which continues to undergird social existence. The springing of life from death is, among other things, the emergence of civilization from barbarism. Most civilized orders are the fruit of carnage, dispossession, occupation, usurpation, or extermination. There is little the founders of nations need to be told about original sin. As Marcel Detien writes, the fatherland, property, work, the human person are all to be credited to sacrifice as a social phenomenon. Hegel sees history as a slaughter bench on which innumerable sacrifices have been performed. However deeply these primordial trespasses are thrust into the political unconscious, the guilt they breed continues to fester, and it is not hard to see sacrifice as one means of seeking to assuage it, as well as being part of the violence and brutality to which it offers a symbolic solution. The real or blood offering which lies at the root of the symbolic order, is unable to figure fully within it. But like a banished ghost, lurking at its edges, it can be evoked in the act of sacrifice by a symbolic performance, glimpsed in stylized form, shown rather than stated. In reliving this primordial act of violence, men and women acknowledge themselves to be dependent on certain capricious, sublimely impenetrable powers, which they are unable to bend to their own purposes without danger of hubris and impiety. In this sense, sacrifice is a critique of the ethic of self-sovereignty. It recognizes the self as an effect of the other. One's identity is not one's own, but lies in the keeping of the gods. Like repression in the judgment of Freud, sacrifice is doomed to be a recurrent process rather than a punctual event. If its gestures of homage and reparation must be endlessly repeated, it is, among other things, because the violence that sustains the social order cannot be fully dredged to consciousness. It is on such collective amnesia that civilization thrives. As long as society continues to breed conflict and repression, it remains caught within the ambit of its bloody origins, unable to break out of that long catastrophe into history proper. Instead, the human narrative becomes a series of ingeniously innovative ways of disavowing its own disreputable parentage. If we desire a future, it is partly in order to bury the past. It is possible to see sacrifice as involving an exchange of powers. There is that which must be lost for the sake of a greater gain. Rather, as the gods grant you a military victory in return for an appropriate number of mutilated oxen, so in Freud's eyes, civilization itself turns upon a sacrificial compact. In a felix culpa or fortunate fall, we pay for our cathedrals and civic institutions in the coinage of repression and neurosis, accepting a certain loss of jouissance or shedding of a symbolic pound of flesh in return for our accession to language, identity, and the symbolic order. The human subject who sacrifices this or that gratifying object is able to do so only because of a deeper trade-off or primordial act of forfeiture, one which is constitutive of subjectivity itself. At the root of human history lies a self-dispossession so deep-seated that any complete recovery from it is out of the question. If it is the gods who help to foster guilt in pre-modern cultures, in Freud's view, it is the law of the father, or superego, that represents a pure culture of the death drive in modern times. As in the rite of sacrifice, guilt, death, compulsive repetition, symbolic displacement, the suspension of time, the need to expiate some nameless guilt, and the urge to self-extinction converge in a single lethal syndrome. Ritual sacrifice, like neurosis, is a sign of the problem to which it offers a dubious solution. Only by overthrowing the punitive law of the father could this whole deadly dispensation be set aside. We shall learn later that this is part of the significance of Calvary. Let us turn briefly to a literary example of the relations between violence and civilization. The founding of a civilization is the telos of Virgil's Aeneid, but it is an endpoint beset with troubles. The gods scrap among themselves, prophecies may be dark and uncertain, and hubris may erupt to wreck the best-laid providential schemes. Rather, as for Freud, eros finds its path to its true home, death, only by the series of digressions and diversions known as life. So Aeneas, homesick for a future that he will not live to see, is delayed by various plot entanglements which impede his historic mission. He must extricate himself from these distractions, leaving the grief-stricken Dido behind and resisting the lure of premature settlements. Thrace, Crete, Carthage, Sicily. Eros may be the driving force of the civilizing process, but in the form of love imbroglios, it can also fatally obstruct it. The poem presents erotic love as a question of violence, madness, poison, wounding, fatality, and deadly affliction. So that desire must be deferred, the reality principle allowed to triumph over the pleasure principle, if the coherent thrust of the narrative is not to disintegrate into so many fragmentary episodes. As the bearer of a lineage, a divine destiny or historic project, Aeneas is no more a free agent than any other literary character, and must forego his gratification if civilization is to be established. At the same time, the various detours and deviations from that end are what constitute the story. The goddess Juno is powerless to thwart the Trojans' final arrival in Latium, but she can delay that triumph by fomenting war, and without such deferments there would be no narrative. In Freud's view, Eros finds its beginning in its end, as the ego discovers in death a refuge akin to the blissful state that reigned before it embarked on its ill-starred journey. Dido discovers her own version of such a sanctuary in the act of suicide. The erotic, as regressive pleasure, thus, has a tendency to elide the business of narrative, curving back constantly to an earlier state of affairs, and thus posing a threat to Eros as builder of cities and historical project. Yet that, too, is a matter of regress as well as progress. The Rome that Aeneas is seeking to establish is likewise a return to origins, since the Trojan nation itself was founded by the Italian warrior Dardanus. As a second Troy, Rome is the repetition of an origin, eliding time in the manner of Eros. Prophecy too garbles time, folding the future into the present. As its name suggests, Latium is a place of hiding, a region in which Saturn, fleeing from Jupiter, sought shelter. And it is here that the bruised and battered voyagers will finally come to rest, as the bruised and battered ego, in Freud's view, will ultimately find its resting place. So it is that Virgil's great epic records the violent prehistory of the Roman nation, forging a shapely narrative from the tumult of war and the chaos of nature, rather as civilization itself plucks a coherent project from these unruly forces. Rome has its murky roots in the rapine and atrocity of the Trojan War, and the city's remote progenitor, Aeneas, is an outcast and wanderer, leader of a rootless, buffeted, war-weary remnant who form a fragile link between past and present. Yet this history of senseless warfare and spiteful deities is converted by the poem itself into a prolegomenon to the glorious present. Otherwise, random episodes are stitched into the seamless continuity of providence, alchemized into the sacred provenance of the nation. We know that Aeneas will achieve his goal because the poem itself exists in all its burnished splendor, the fruit of a nation that can now glance over its shoulder and survey its own barbarous beginnings. Assured that this history of carnage has issued in a felicitous end, Rome now exerts dominion over the various powers that sought to wreck the process of its emergence, powers of which Aeneas and his companions are often enough portrayed as the helpless playthings. The narrative of national destiny has triumphed over a prehistory of misfortune. Once it is established, however, civilization by no means provides respite from the blood-stained narrative that went into its making. On the contrary, it is largely a perpetuation of that grim tale, a higher form of barbarism, so to speak, under the name of law, empire, and universal order. Civilized society, with its endless imperial expansion, proves to be the reverse of a resting place, as Rome visits on less well-favored peoples the mayhem and carnage from which it itself arose, thus returning to its own origins in a rather less glorious sense than the production of national monuments like the Aeneid. The violence which was the prelude to civility continues to flourish within that civilized condition, mitigated in some ways by its doctrines and technologies, yet in other ways intensified by them. Among other things, those anarchic forces are sublimated into the legitimate violence of the law, which helps to secure the conditions within which national epics like the Aeneid can be written. As Slavoj Žižek remarks, such law represents the violence which sustains the very containment of violence. In the licensed aggression of the judiciary and armed forces, barbarism and civilization are now well nigh indistinguishable. The final guarantee of civility is state-sanctioned death. Yet this state of affairs had long been anticipated. In myth, writes Walter Burkert, the most gruesome tales of living creatures torn apart and of cannibalism are presented in conjunction with the achievements of civilized life. In the ambivalences of myth, as well as in that coupling of the blessed and the cursed known as the sacred, one can glimpse a recognition that death and dismemberment lurk at the source of peace and prosperity. In Aeschylus's Oresteia, the fearful forces that rage beyond the pale of civilization and threaten to thrust it back into primeval slime will finally be enshrined within its borders. As the Furies are metamorphosed into the Eumenides or Kindly Ones. Figures of terror in pre-modern times must be sweet-talked and cajoled, treated in a diplomatic fiction as good-hearted and well-disposed, which is one reason for the blurring of boundaries between the horrific and the holy, signified by the word sacred. That which threatens to sink social order without trace is appropriated, sublimated, and turned outwards, converted into a defense against the city's foes. In an arresting paradox, the violence which salvaged civilization from dust and slime now takes the form of the law that protects it from both outside invasion and internal insurrection. Barbarism and civilization are synchronous rather than sequential, two sides of the same coin rather than consecutive historical stages. One must acknowledge that there are forces constitutive of human culture that are also capable of tearing it apart. Sacrifice is, among other things, a way of seeking to accommodate these death-dealing yet potentially world-creating powers, clinging to the claims of civility while recognizing their dependence on divine or demonic energies which run deeper than rationality. If reason is to flourish, it must be conscious of its own modest capabilities, illuminating those shadowy frontiers where it trails off into darkness and non-being. What is true of the Oresteia in this respect is also the case in Euripides' The Bacchae. The self must be founded on the non-self, law and order on pain and terror, the polis on a refined version of the very savagery it has apparently put behind it. You must seek to win over these sacred powers through an act of symbolic identification with them, but not to the point where, like Pentheus in the Bacchae, they end up tearing you limb from limb. To greet them with due reverence is not to capitulate to them. Instead, they must be incorporated into the social order, not least in the form of the sublime terror of the law, so that consent to political authority may be reinforced with coercion. The problem is how such coercion is to buttress consent rather than destroy it. There is no sacrifice without a seething undercurrent of ressentiment. No meek obeisance.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.